And we're on. Marty Gallagher, thanks for being on the show.
My pleasure.
Yeah, so I don't remember the first time that I heard about you. It was a long time ago. I started as a personal trainer in 1999. So I'm sure you're in, and I've been like reading about the, you know, since I was like 7 years old. So I'm sure you were somewhere in the magazines and stuff that I was reading. And then I started learning more when I got into like kettlebells and reading like Pavel Satsula, and then him mentioning you. And then, you know, I read your books, The Purposeful Primitive, Strong Medicine, and then articles. And what was really drawing my interest besides, yeah, you can squat a whole bunch and you have these, you know, amazing numbers in your lifts, is like digging into like the Zen part of it. And from my view of looking at it, like we were just about to start talking about before we hit record, is like lifting as kind of an internal martial art, or blending the internal martial art with the lifting using, yes, those techniques. So if we could start there, if you could just want to give your perspective of like maybe how you started, because like I was just reading, say you had your first meet in 1968.
Oh, no, that's actually a little late. I started lifting weights in 1961 as an 11-year-old, and then my first formalized mental recalibration program is what we were introduced into, the whole Soviet Iron Curtain auto visualization, which was what the Soviet lifters used. You'd see them, if you'd see any of the great Russian lifters of the 60s and the 70s, and they stride out to the, and even the 80s, and they stride out to the barbell, and they're just standing there with their eyes closed. Nobody's going, what are they doing? What they're doing is that they're running a repetitive movie of themselves doing the about to happen lift, and they run it over and over and over, and it drills into their mind this image and this pattern of success. So that's what we were taught to do. We were taught to, now you don't have to use auto visualization on your, you know, 135 pound warm up, but on your heavy sets, yeah, you recalibrate your mind. You purposefully, you're trying to put yourself in the zone, right? And what the Soviets and the East Germans scientists discovered that is that this actually works. This it hones technique. It puts you in the proper headspace that you need to for the specificity of the event that you're doing. It's not just confined to weightlifting. You'll see elite bobsled drivers, you know, at the Winter Olympics, and before it's their time, they're looking at them backstage, and their eyes are closed, and they're doing this, and what they're doing is audio visualization. They're running themselves through that whatever 2.8-mile course, whatever it is, over and over, every turn, everything, over and over and over and over and over. And if you do it for a lot of years, I started doing that auto visualization, I guess, when I was 12. By the time I was 17, I'd won a national championship as an Olympic weightlifter, right? And I had my auto-visualization technique down pretty good. And so in 1970, it was a short hop, skip, and jump from Soviet East German auto-visualization into formalized meditation, right?
And did you have a meditation teacher? Are you reading these from books? Did you have
combination? You know, I think the jump in for me was Paramahansa Yogananda's Autobiography of Yoga. So that kind of led me into all the Hindu nomenclature, and you get into the Bhagavad Gita and the Upanishads, and you know, the different Indian saints, Sri Aurobindo, Ramakrishna. You know, you work through the Hindu literature, and they have a very, and I was looking for the nuts and bolts of the meditational techniques, right? Mm-hmm. I was not seeking enlightenment. I wasn't seeking a religion. I wasn't seeking, you know, what I wanted was I wanted to see how they were altering their minds and if there was anything that they were doing that I could take back to the world of athletics. Okay. And in the Hindu, it was interesting. The Hindu, it's very internalized with a high level Hindu meditator. They can shoot a gun off behind their head and they won't hear it. Right. Mm. They're able to shut it out. Now you do the same thing with a high level Zen master and they hear it, but they don't react to it.
Right.
Right. So it's a difference. If you look at the Hindu tradition of the fakirs, the guys who would lay on nails and, you know, bury themselves. And what they were doing is they were using meditational and breath techniques to do these extraordinary feats to, you know, bring attention to their, you know, their gurus, their religion, their practices. So, you know, you work through that. And then from then I went into the Zen. And, you know, in the Zen tradition, you have Soto and Rinzi. And the Rinzi is Koan, K-O-A-N, and they give you an unsolvable riddle, and you ponder it and ponder it and ponder it till eventually your conventional discursive reasoning is pierced, and you know you have a burst of enlightenment, right?
Yeah.
The Soto school is different. They're just like, we don't seek anything, just sit, you know, just do the work. And that's the Dogen Zenji that founded that school. And that appealed to me mightily, this idea of just don't have any thoughts of gain, just sit and just get into the mechanics of the breathing and the posture. You know, the uprightness and just do that and don't be seeking to see visions or, you know what I mean? Or religious euphoria. So, you know, you work through that. And then, from Zen, we jumped off into, the Taoist to China, you know, and there it's the Northern Chinese tradition of Taoism, and of course the Taoist and also in Zen. The Zen was heavily linked to the Budu, to the samurai, to the warrior, and they had a Moku San, which was application of meditation for heavy sport and combat, and they'd use it, a lot of the Kendo players would use it right before they, you know, beat the hell out of each other with sticks. And the idea is you want to place yourself in a mindless, wordless state that makes you completely receptive to incoming. If you're intuitive, you're more able to deal with the spontaneous actions of an opponent. If you're preoccupied, well, then you have an Achilles heel. Right.
Yeah. The Zen stuff appealed to me. I started reading about like the yoga stuff, philosophy in different ways when I got my first two yoga books at a Grateful Dead concert in 1994. And it was like Krishna consciousness stuff about the Bhagavad Gita, that kind of stuff. And then I started Japanese jujitsu when I was 18. That was 1997. Okay. And every class had 10 minutes of meditation at the end, Zen meditation, real formal. And then sometimes we had like hour-long meditations where like 20 minutes seated and then a walking meditation in between sets. And yeah, like not seeking anything particularly amazing, just like there, it can be like real, not very exciting, but exciting things can happen, but that's not, just like you're saying, that's not what you're what you're chasing. And so when you're already lifting and then you're reading about this stuff, how did you start making the connection between, like, say, doing a deadlift and what maybe the samurai are talking about, like with the Soto Zen, Zazen, and...
Well, what's the commonality? The mental commonality is that whether it's a limit attempt, and you don't have to be an elite athlete or an elite warrior, but just a limit attempt, something 100 or 102% of your particular capacity, that creates what I term a hormonal tsunami. When you have intense physical effort, for example, absolute strength consists of, you know, short movements, maximum payload, power lift, you know, a squat, a deadlift, a bench press. You know, these are very short movements, but you're using maximum weight, no real regard for velocity. And if you work at 100% of your capacity, whether it's a 3-rep set or a 5-rep set or an 8-rep set, you'll have a hormonal release. Your body will release hormones. It doesn't happen if you're cruising along at 75 to 80% of capacity. And that's what a lot of people miss. A lot of guys are doing, like, I do 5 times 5. Well, that's great, but that's never 100 times 1, you know? Mm-hmm. And the hormonal release, and it's endorphins, it's adrenaline, it's serotonin, it's a half a dozen different chemicals that release into the body, and it creates what, you know, we call the after workout bliss state. You know how good you feel after a really kick-ass workout? Mm-hmm. That's attributable to hormonal release. Okay, you just feel good, right? And also, if you've been successful in the workout, that compounds it. So, but what athletes didn't realize is that when they achieve that post-workout hormonal bliss, it's actually an advanced meditational state, right? What's the goal of meditation? The goal of meditation, whether it's Hindu, Taoist, Zen, whatever, is to achieve that mindless, where the internal thinker, the observer, the talker falls silent. But not from some act of willpower. You can't use your mind to force your mind to be quiet. That's just another clever act of will. The mind has to fall silent of its own accord. Extreme effort will cause it to fall silent of its own accord. Right. Intense meditation can do that, but extreme exercise is a lot quicker. Jumping off the side of a mountain in a wingsuit will give you that same hormonal excitation. Jumping off a bridge with a bungee cord. We do it through squats and deadlifts and bench presses, right? And we also recognize it for what it is, and it is an advanced meditational state. Athletes just didn't recognize it as such, and they haven't nurtured it as such. We're just pointing it out. So it's sort of an intense training. Intense progressive resistance training is sort of a backdoor to, you know, advanced meditational states. It's kind of cool.
Yeah, that's right where I am too. When I was starting out, I was like, you know, studying martial arts and, okay, well, what are these people from Japan saying? And what about the people from China and India? And like, okay, they're using different words for the same thing. Like, what do they have in common? Okay, I'm going to do that. You know, the one thing that the guy that's far off, he's the only one saying this thing. Maybe I'm not going to pay attention to that right now. I'm going to do the stuff that they're all talking about. And so just like focus on that kind of stuff. And, you know, sometimes, so I was a strong first instructor for 4 years. And so reading about Pavel Sadzulin, when I first started reading about him, like about 10 years ago or whatever it was, he seemed to kind of embody what I was trying to do. It's not about the lift. It's like what you can do other than just lift the weight and like apply it to martial arts. And so I'm reading and then end up getting certified through him. And then one of my partners at my gym, I have a gym here in Indianapolis, is Valeri Fedorenko. And so I'm learning all this stuff that Pavel says, and then Valeri Fedorenko, everything is completely the opposite. And he has all these world records, and he does all these insane feats.
I love world records.
Yeah, it's proof that what you're doing works. And so his breathing, it's the opposite. You know, he exhales at the bottom, he inhales at the top, he inhales through his mouth and his nose at the same time, doing the lifting up on the jerk, and it's like exact opposite. So have you found like you have this method and it's working, and then somebody else is doing something that has better numbers, it's like, yeah, actually I do everything the opposite of what
I'm a product of a school of strength. I was I had the good fortune, I guess, of growing up in an area that was a hotbed of Olympic weightlifting, and I got good instruction right from the very start by experienced, seasoned men. Mm-hmm. Right. So I was drilled and schooled in the techniques, and they drilled into me a reverence for technique. Olympic lifting is different. Again, when you think of strength, you have to generalize in three broad categories. On the extreme left, you would have absolute strength, and that would be the power lifts, and that would be maximum payload, short distance, no real regard for velocity. Okay. Then in the middle, you'd have explosive strength, the Olympic lifts, right? And that's moderate payload, maximum velocity, long distances, right?
Right.
Okay. Then on the extreme right, you'd have strength endurance, or sustained strength, which would be light payloads, long duration. Yeah, velocities can vary. You know, it doesn't matter. That's like the MMA guys. They love they're sustained strength masters. They do stuff like, you know, pick up a 100-pound heavy bag and run up a hill.
Right.
That's sustained strength. You're injecting an element of strength into a cardiovascular format, right? Muscular contraction in a sustained fashion. Build a bigger gas tank. So, but you have to have elements of all three: absolute strength, explosive strength, sustained strength, to have a comprehensive program. If you concentrate on any one or the other, you know, you become not all that you could be. It's not optimal. Right.
Right.
Bodybuilding, for example, that's high volume, moderate intensity. When Schwarzenegger was at his peak in the 70s, he was doing 700 sets a week.
Yeah.
That was... imagine 700. Like, I think my guys, our power lifters, we might do 50 a week, 50 sets a week. Low volume, high intensity, short sessions. I've got a lot of guys that are just strength training once a week and get incredible results.
Yeah, that was something else. I actually wrote that in my notes to ask you about, because you were around Arnold, and didn't you like actually go there and like you were counting his sets because he was going there twice a day?
No. There's a great, fantastic book by a guy named Rick Wayne, who was the editor-in-chief of Muscle Builder magazine, and Rick wrote a really great book called Three More Reps, and in it he outlined Schwarzenegger's exact training routine when he won the 76 Olympia. And what he did is he trained six times a week, twice a day. He'd go in the morning and do, I don't know, calves, forearms, abs, and then come back in the evening and, you know, he would train each muscle three times a week. And he trained 6 days a week, twice a day, 700 sets a week. Incredible, incredible. You know, and again, just like working in a coal mine.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, that was something I was wanting to ask about too, because I was listening to another video you were on, and you were comparing Arnold's 700 sets a week compared to the guys that have the manual labor jobs and the families, and so they're just too busy to go to the gym. And then on Sundays,
they don't have any energy because they work highly physical jobs.
Yeah.
If you're humping shingles at a construction site, you know, hiking up ladders with a hotter full of bricks or whatever, you know what I mean? You know, you don't have it during the week. You're just exhausted. So classically what they do is they rest up on Saturday and then we hit it on Sunday. Right.
Yeah.
And in 2 hours, we just do all the absolute strength training for the week. Squat, bench press, deadlift, overhead press, maybe some arms. See you later. And they're done that. They're done for the week. And everybody's making gains. This isn't like treading water. We've been doing this for 5 years. And it's, you know, regular guys making sensational gains. They're all competitive lifters. All their lifts are going through the ceiling since they've been doing this stuff. But we're sticklers on technique. And, you know, when you're lifting in front of other alpha males whose opinion you value, you know, you're up your game.
Right.
And you have myself and six-time world champion Kirk Karwoski sitting 15 feet away from you. That don't help either.
Mm. Yeah.
We don't suffer fools lightly. And no one talks when someone's lifting. There's no yakety yak. You get the respect when you're lifting. You give the respect when they're lifting. So, and when we have weak people, we have beginners. I got a kid, this is his third ever progressive resistance training session. But he's such a specimen. It's like, we call him Pat the Project. He's like 35 years old, has never done any serious lifting in his life, but he's got a bone structure like a, you know, silverback gorilla. It says, hey, bud, you know, you want to become a monster? He goes, yeah, that sounds good. So he's training once a week. And, you know, what did he do today? Well, I think this is his third deadlift session, and he pulled, I don't know, 365 for five.
Right. It's pretty good.
Yeah. He says, this, what you know, he's talking while he's doing it. How's this? And I just, yeah, that's great. Keep going. And we're holding him back. You know, he probably could do 405 for five if we let him, but it's like, no, you know, just slow roll this thing.
Yeah.
We got years with this kid. Years.
Yeah. It's something I think about a lot, because I have the gym, but I also have what I call my job that I work from 6 a.m. to 2:30. And then I have clients at the gym, do martial arts a couple times a week. And
yeah. It's exhausting.
Have all this stuff going. So sometimes I only get in one pretty hard
real
session per week. But yeah. I can make I'm definitely not going backwards. And then I can kind of like look back over time, and I'm, you know, doing better at many things over time. And you think part of that is like the amount of recovery time. You get plenty of recovery time in between if you're just doing the ones. Even if you have kind of like a manual labor job, you kind of get used to it. Where if you're hitting the gym,
it's not deadlifting 500. Yeah, absolutely. So it works. And again, I think that also we've been revisiting the whole thing of if you're hitting legs. If you're knocking the hell out of legs on Sunday and then hitting chest and arms on Tuesday, and then back and shoulders on Friday, Is the body ever really rested?
Right.
Kind of gets these jolts, you know, every couple of days, bang, that's a different body part. And the rationale is, well, we're going to knock the hell out of the chest, but the legs can rest. Mm-hmm. Right. Well, maybe recovery is a whole body event.
Right. Yeah.
So that's why we're, I think part of the reason that we're having success with this once every 7 day thing, is they're rested for absolute strength training like we do, but when they come in. Now, they tried to hit it on Tuesday and again on Thursday, plus working, you know, hard jobs. It's like, wow. At best, you'll be able to perform at, you know, 100% of your 82% fatigue effort. Mm-hmm. You know, if you're always fatigued, the best effort is you're 100% rested and you give 102% effort. That's where the gains are.
Right.
Who cares if you give 102% effort, but you're only at 83% of capacity because you're fatigued.
Right. Yeah. And I heard talking about like the, if you have like five guys training together,
yeah.
Are you timing the rest period or is it, no, it's just no, your turn?
No. But we guys aren't sitting in straddle loungers. You know what I mean? I mean, it's like, no, but I mean, by the time you have five, if you have, let's say five guys per platform, which is a good amount. It's a good pace, right? You know, change the weight, you know, this guy goes, by the time you have five guys go, you're ready, let's go. There's no need, you don't need 20 minutes rest. You really don't, swear to God. I mean, I've been training with world champions since the time I was 14,
yeah,
right? And actually, that's all I've ever trained with. And it's a lineage, and people speculate on how, you know, the all-time greats train, but it's, you know, I know, right? I know how I wrote the book on Ed Cohn, you know what I mean? I trained Karwoski. I mentored under Hugh Cassidy, the first world champion, first world heavyweight powerlifting champion. So you have, when you work with the best of the best, you see how they move, how they pace their workouts, you know, how and when they exert, how hard they exert, you know, how they psych, right? Mm. How they walk, talk, look, and act, right? The best of the best.
Right. Yeah.
And as a competition coach, I worked with Lamar Gant, Joe Ladnier, you know, a who's who of every great powerlifter on the face of the planet. I've worked with in competition, and that's when you see who rises and who wilts. You know, it's a strange thing, pure strength. But this is all gone. This is all 20 years back. I've been off the scene for a long time. I basically stay in my isolation and do my Tao thing, my Taoist thing. And that, you know, that's what I do. That's what I do every day.
Have you seen the training frequency influence how long into somebody's life they can train at a, I guess, relatively high level? So that's something I think about too, because I'm not really trying to break world records. I want to be healthy and strong when I'm old. I want to be a good martial artist when I'm old.
I'll be 70 in April, okay? And we have a phrase: dare to be weak. Okay, right. You've got to make allowances for age.
Yeah.
But here's what I know. I can work at 100% of my current capacity.
Right.
I can beat whatever I did last week.
Yeah.
I'm not comparing myself to 1983. Okay. But I compare myself to last week. Right. And I can improve on that. Trust me. And that's enough. But I can't fudge on the rules. The techniques have to be crisp. There has to be uniformity, and there has to be a consistency. I'm not only trained once a week, but I trained today. I trained my, I had my once a week training session today and knocked the hell out of it, you know. But I had, you know, if you only do it once a week, let me tell you, you think about it going into the session. That's another thing. Mm. You don't get, I've got five sessions this week, and, you know, I think people train too much, man. I don't think they put enough emphasis on, you know, less is better if less is more intense.
Yeah.
Both physically and psychologically.
Yeah. It's something I think about a lot, because I end up doing, like I said, about once per week of a hard workout, and I like record videos. So I might, when I'm like recording videos, I'm not using the heaviest weight I can to show off for the video. I'm demonstrating with a pretty moderately lightish weight, but I'm still like doing stuff.
No one cares.
Right.
You could wave around a 600 pound kettlebell and no one would notice.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's that's the thing. Everyone in their ego has, like, there's some audience of 10,000 that's watching their every move, and it's, no one's there, dude.
Yeah.
Just be weak, but be precise and be technically accurate and use full range of motion and make it harder, not easier, right? In terms of progressive resistance training. We do cardio. We love cardio. And we'll mix it up. We'll do steady state long distance. I love to sprint. I just think sprinting is the best complement for hardcore resistance training.
Yeah.
You know, and then the nutrition, you have to have a nutritional element. You know, I live in the country, so we like, I don't know, whatever you want to call it, gourmet peasant food, you know, with the country vegetables and the butchered meat from animals that, you know, are local, organic, you know, that kind of a vibe. So everybody's healthy because we're strong externally from the lifting, we're strong internally from the cardio, we got a good diet thing going, you know. No one's on medication, no one gets sick, but strong people are resilient.
Right. Have you changed your, like, see, one, like, point of controversy is the trap bar.
And I don't know nothing about that.
You don't ever use those or have, like, opinions on them or?
No. Next.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just like wondering, like, how you may have changed your
Nothing's changed,
like, range of motion for your squats or changed anything.
No,
everything's the same as it always has.
Just who I was taught to me, because what I was taught was you use extreme range of motion. You can't get no more extreme than extreme all you can do. That's it.
Yeah.
And our benches were long pauses and our deadlifts were locked out and we weren't allowed to let the weight settle on the floor. It was touch and go deadlifts and no one dropped deadlifts in my day. Are you kidding me? That gets you kicked out.
Hmm. Yeah.
Everyone now, they pull a deadlift to the top and then they drop it. Oh, look at me. I'm so strong. 405, five reps. Everyone, look at me. I can drop this weight. And it's like, if you did that in Hugh Cassidy's basement, first you get your ass kicked and then you get thrown out because it would be impolite. You know, you're going to drop poundage in somebody's basement because you don't want to do the negative. Well, the negative is where all the gains and the growth is.
Yeah. Control both ways. Makes sense to me.
You don't throw away the negative in the deadlift. I mean, in the bench press, you don't throw away the negative in the squat. Why would you throw it away purposely in the deadlift? Because it's easier. Just drop it and then invent some rationale as to why that's superior.
Yeah.
It doesn't change it that it's not.
Right.
Sorry.
Yeah. So are you still training like military units and like do you?
Yeah, but I like to keep that on the down low. Yeah, I work with the best of the best of the best. But let's just leave it at this. They're attracted also to the minimalism because of how many skill sets they have to keep on top of. Right. If you're right. If you're an active duty commando, well, what do you got to do? You got to get practice jumping out of airplanes. You got to practice combat fighting. You got to practice knife fighting. You got to practice pistol shooting. You got to practice what else? Defensive driving, defusing a nuclear bomb. I don't know. You know what I mean? And all those skill sets you have to revisit or you'll lose them. So they came to me and they said, well, we understand and we love the need for strength. We don't have any time. Can you help us? And I went, oh, I got just the program for you. Mm-hmm. When they're stateside, they're very busy. Now, when they're deployed, they have a lot more time. So that's when I usually turn them over to my partner, Jim Steele, University of Pennsylvania strength coach, 20 years. And Jim opens and expands their training program because they're like sitting around, they're bored. So it's like, okay, let's do some more training. But it's still keeping with the same generalized philosophy of fewer movements done with more intensity.
Right.
So, yeah.
And are they, can I say like what techniques are they doing? Is it the squat, bench, deadlift? Yeah, are they doing?
Yeah. And yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolute strength. If you want to get that Mike Tyson knockout strength or that brute strength is what they want. They don't need cardio. They get plenty of cardio doing their damn job, right?
Right.
And they really don't need explosive strength all that much because they do a lot of explosive stuff. Leaping, bounding, jumping, fighting, you know what I mean? But what they really like is that absolute strength, that brutal strength that also builds muscle and power. And it's like, give us that. That's what we all want, more of that. That helps us hump our 80 pounds of gear easier. That helps us hump mortar base plates easier. That helps everything. That helps us if we have to drag a comrade off the field while he's wounded and I have to return fire with the other hand and he weighs 280 pounds with his gear on. But I only have a 250-pound deadlift, so I can't do anything about it. Mm. Unacceptable.
Right. Yeah, I saw they recently changed the requirements, the PT requirements for the Army to have the deadlift. They use the trap bar, but whatever, and then some other strength they have to meet.
It's totally different. That's like the difference between, it's completely different.
Right.
And I have no connection with that world.
Yeah.
That generalized world. No, this is different. My people are motivated professionals and they want the knowledge. I don't have to convince them of the knowledge. And I'm not interested in talking to anybody that's not motivated. It's not my job. I'm not here to motivate you. If you don't want to get motivated, well, just step aside because I know that there are plenty of people are. And I will work with a highly motivated, out of shape person before I will work with an unmotivated superstar. I learned a lesson on that, so.
Yeah, that makes sense. Like, what kind of warm up stuff do you do? Is the warm up just
the lift?
Doing like the lift,
lighter sets of the lift. But again, we're using full and complete range of motion, so it's highly specific. And we take small jumps. We don't take big jumps. 30-pound jumps is pretty standard for us. So, you go 135, 165, 195, 225, 255, 285, 350. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And just at every bus stop, whoever wants that poundage jumps in. Who wants 295? Oh, yeah, okay. Step up, do your set, whatever your prescribed reps are, because it'll differ, step back out. Everybody has a periodized regimen that it's a 12-week cycle, and they'll have a target. Every time they come in that door, they have a target poundage and reps in each lift for that day. And they make that, and they check it off, and then they move on. But no one just walks in and goes, oh, well, you know. No, everybody has a predetermined goal.
And so what kind of the warm-ups, it takes, you know, of course, the higher the weight, the longer it takes to get there, right? But is it how do you how many, like, what kind of, like, programming or cycles do you vary the kind of program? Okay, I'm going to do a linear cycle.
Yes.
And then
we love contrast. If you've done 12 weeks where you're concentrating on power and strength, which almost invariably includes some lean muscle up, right? A little bit heavier eating, okay? Probably a little less cardio. What better contrast than after you do 12 weeks, 3 months of that, go, man, I'm tired of that. Let me shift back the other direction. Let's do moderate poundage, higher volume lifting, more frequent sessions, more cardio. Let's lighten up the eating, right? So now we're shifting back. Now you're refining that size that you built. And it's like, and then we like to sync it up with the seasons. Like, what better time to add size and strength than in the deepest of the winter? Mm. What better time to get maximally ripped than in August, right?
Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah. And then the spring and the fall are transitional, always. But the deepest of the winter, well, that's when I want to, well, I live in the mountains of Pennsylvania. So that's when I want to, you know, add the plates on the bar and eat some, you know, lamb stew and, right? And it's different. And then in the summertime, it's like, okay, lighter, more, faster, more cardio, more activity, because it's the summertime, less eating, who cares? You know, I mean, it's like eating, who even thinks about that, right? Because we're so active and then get maximally ripped. And then you get tired of that come fall, and it's like, oh man, I'm so skinny. Let's put some size back on, right? And it's just a very nice holistic ebb and flow, and it actually ties into primordial. You know, if you look back, there was 800,000 years of man before agriculture was invented. Agriculture was only invented 10,000 years ago, very recent development. Before that, people, it's in their DNA, we're seasonal. You know? Well, I mean, if you're in my kind of climate, your kind of climate too, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it makes sense getting in tune with the seasons and what kind of, like, naturally happens. Yeah. There's like some, I work at I train at a wilderness survival school also, teach like strength, yeah, conditioning, martial arts stuff. And it's divided into like the eight directions, but also seasonal things.
Yeah.
And so it just kind of like makes sense, like what you eat, what you do, the activity. And so it's, there's definitely something to being in tune with the seasons and what there is to eat naturally, and then what your body can do with that energy. Makes sense.
You can't train the same or eat the same all year round and expect radical changes. Right. You know, why would the body dramatically transform itself because you keep doing what you're the same stuff?
Right.
Where is the incentive there, man? Right. Mm-hmm. What do you got to do? Well, you got to do something dramatically different. Not barely different, dramatically different. You got to jolt it a little bit. And hopefully you've had a nice run and you've made some good gains in whatever direction you've selected. Now it's time to slash back the other direction. And it keeps the body guessing, and you know, you just don't want to fossilize. You see it all the time. Every time I go to the YMCA, I can go 2 years apart and I'll see the same people doing the same exercises with the same poundage at the same time of day. You know, they don't change. Oh, they get older or they get worse, but it's, you know, and it's, and everybody's working at that, you know, 60 to 75% level, and they ride the bikes, and it's just not enough.
Yeah.
There's not enough intensity there to cause the body to do anything about it. The body grows muscle as a defensive measure. If you don't stress it, there's no need for it to grow that muscle. The muscle is there to help the trauma, right? To help it against these future attacks where it's continually overloaded. We can't deal with this. Help us. What do we do? Oh, I've got an idea. Let's build some more muscle. Then we'll be better able to resist this continual onslaught of more than we can handle. Oh, well, that's how we grow. But if there's no continual onslaught, right? Same with cardio. You're not going to melt fat. First off, you're not going to melt fat if you have a bad diet. You can run a marathon. You can be a cardio fanatic. You can be cardio 3 hours a day. But if you don't have the nutrition in control, you'll never melt that fat. The fat doesn't come off if there's insulin in the bloodstream. Boom.
Yeah, and when you're like changing things up, I was listening to, I don't remember which video it was now, but you're talking about like kettlebell front squats, like for people.
Yep. Goblet squat. That's our entry level squat. We love the goblet squat.
Mm-hmm.
Teaches all the right angles: upright torso, vertical shins, knees over ankles. You know, when you arise, nothing but leg power. That's what we want in our squats. And we try to replicate that goblet squat to the front squat, again, with the up, you know, vertical torso, vertical shins, nothing but the femurs moving. Then, and only then, do we allow them to go to high bar back squat, and again, hopefully replicate that vertical shin, vertical torso, nothing moving but the femurs. Then and only then, low bar back squat. If most trainees jump in on low bar back squat, then it's just an invitation to bend forward. And it turns the world's best leg exercise into some sort of half-ass back exercise, like a good morning.
Yeah.
It's exercise malpractice.
Yeah. I like the kettlebell front squat. I often use two. Depend on what I'm doing. Yeah. Sometimes I just like one heavy one on one side, sometimes using two. And it's deceptively hard if I'm using two 70 pounders.
It'll give you all you can handle, brother.
Yeah.
If you can do a lot of people, there's no need to ever progress past kettlebell squats. Okay. If you conk your legs out on five reps, I mean, it doesn't matter what the implement is.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and the technique is so fabulous with the goblet squat, again, because it's all leg. That's what we want in our squats, all leg.
Yeah.
So yeah, knock that. I mean, just push that, man. We push it up where you can do 10 reps. You know, again, ass on heels, all the way down, all the way locked out. When you can do 10 reps, get a bigger belt. And often what we'll do, you know, there's big jumps between the bells. We'll tape a 2.5 or a 5 pound plate on the bottom of the bell with duct tape.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You tracking, right?
Mm-hmm.
That way you don't have to jump from whatever, you know, there's some big spaces between those bells.
Yeah. 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 I'm a big fan of those. I think they apply well to, like I'm always thinking like how does stuff apply to martial arts, and if you have like a couple, whether it's one or two heavy kettlebells in the front, it kind of helps you stay upright. Like if you're resisting takedowns or even going for your own like upper body throws and that kind of stuff, to me, it really applies, has to those situations. When do you ever do like the Jefferson deadlifts and
the only variation that we'll do is we will have the guys in the off season. How do you create contrast in the deadlift? Well, one thing you can do is you can do deadlifts off standing on a 100-pound plate if you're a conventional deadlifter. So it's maybe 2.5 or 3 inches. Mm-hmm. So you put the start of the deadlift at a deficit. And by putting it at a deficit, when you go back to the floor, it feels so much easier.
Yeah. Right.
So we'll do that. Also, we'll do what they call rack pulls, where we'll load it up and pull for maybe the last 6 inches. And that builds upper back traps, rhomboids, and also grip power. So we like that. Those would be the only two assistants. We spend a lot of time doing the deadlift because it's such a complex technical exercise. We want practice on it. It's to me, it's the most difficult. It took me 10 years to perfect my deadlift form. It's like a sword. It's like a samurai with a sword pattern. It's a matter of at the highest level, it's a matter of millimeters. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, how often are you throwing the rack pulls in? I like those because you can just how you can just put ridiculous amount of weight on and
yeah, everybody likes that. Plus what they'll do is they'll wear straps, so then they can really partially pull some weight. The problem with it is that rack pulls by themselves, it's fool's gold, because the whole game in deadlifting is getting it to that position. It's the first two-thirds of the movement. The last third of the movement is easy. You get through the first two-thirds, nobody loses a deadlift at the top, other than grip, right? Mm-hmm. So, again, we would only do rack pulls in the off season. The off season being preseason is 12 weeks leading up to a competition, actually 13 weeks leading up to a competition. The off season is the time after the competition before you have to start the next pre-meet cycle. So ideally if you had two competitions a year, which would be 12 weeks and 12 weeks, that would be 24 weeks. Then you'd have two off seasons of 12 weeks and 12 weeks. That'd be 48 weeks. Then you'd have 4 weeks of, vacation.
Right. Yeah. Do you ever go the other way? Like set the bar underneath another bar, so you pull up to like your knees and then hit the bars and just like have like a loaded isometric pulling into the rack that way?
Oh, that's real old school. That's the way we used to do it back when the racks first came out. We'd break the movement down into three parts and you'd set the pins. And let's say on the deadlift, the first pull would be from the floor to the knee. And you'd pull three reps, and on the third rep, you pull it against the top pin and hold it as long as you can until it took you down. Then your next set would be you'd set the bar on top of that pin. Mm. You'd put another pin, 6 inches above that, and you'd one, two, and on the third rep, pull it and hold it up against the top pin as long as you can, right? And then down. And then the final one would be the top pull for an Olympic lift. You'd set the bar on top of that. Then you shrug it up. And on the third rep, you just hold it up as long as you can. And you do the same thing in the squat, the bench press, any other lift. We found that cutting the lift into thirds was like too small. We cut it into halves. So on the benches, you would take down to halfway and then push back up. And you push up against the top pin, which helps your lockout. Yeah, I think there's some, I think that's dessert. I don't think it's the main course. I don't think it's the meat and potatoes, but I think it's a tasty dessert.
Yeah, just throw it in one day, see what happens, and then back to...
No. I mean, I don't throw anything in just one day. If you're going to include something, put it in for at least 4 weeks. That way you get a fix if there's validity to it.
Right. Yeah. That's neighbors.
I thought maybe it was the owl.
Could have been. Sometimes I do think it makes some noise.
Anyway, all right. How we doing, man?
Yeah. We can start to wrap it up here. I don't want to take all of your Sunday up. So, so you're still doing quite a bit of writing and what are your current projects?
Oh my God. I'm under contract for 7 articles a month. Okay. In addition, I always have a book project going, and I have a podcast every Friday with Iron Company. Mm-hmm. We've got, if any of your people are interested in my strategies, I would, if they're more lifter, strong oriented, I would, direct them toward Purposeful Primitive. Mm-hmm. That's sort of the hardcore manifesto. That's 450 pages. They can get that through Dragon Door. If they're more broad-based, regular type folks, certainly Strong Medicine, which is a book I did with Dr. Chris Hardy. And Chris is a top flight naval doctor. So this is, generalized public. This is like the book you give your parents or something. You know what I mean? Somebody's who's not in the best shape and wants to tighten up. This is good stuff. Anybody who's in the Washington, D.C. area, we're putting on a intensive one-day clinic on the bench press and the overhead press. I'll have Jim Steele with me. I have 6-time world champion, 7-time national champion, Kirk Karwoski. And we're going to drill down into both the bench press and the overhead press techniques. There's 5 variations in each of those 2 lifts. And we take the folks through each of the sequential variations. And again, you've got Kirk there, 600-pound raw bencher. This is the second. We have like an ongoing series of, we're really trying to get these techniques out to the general public because we feel that it's techniques and tactics. Because in addition to every seminar where we workshop techniques, there's always a tactical part of it.
Yeah, sounds good. 5 variations of each that people can dial in. The idea is for people pick the main one that's right for them.
It's more like work your way through boot camp. And folks might not ever need to progress past a certain level. It's not like, oh, it's like school that they have to go through all 5 grades. Many people never, for example, like we talked about, they never really have to go past the kettlebell deadlift. I mean, that's plenty. I mean, listen, that's a fabulous exercise. And there's no, it's like, oh, if you don't go to a barbell squatting, you're a failure. It's like, no. Whatever the tool is that allows you to exert maximally and safely, that's where we want to be, right?
Right. Yeah, very, very cool. So how can people find you, your...
ironcompany.com. And, we're a big presence there. Jim Steele and I do a podcast every Friday and that's live, and we discuss every topic under the sun. Additionally, I post a column every week, and I'll talk about just about any crazy subject that comes to mind as it relates to health and fitness. So you really might want to check that out too. Because again, we carry so many different topics, right? It's not just lifting. It's progressive resistance training, it's nutrition, it's cardiovascular training, and it's brain training, which we talked about, the psychology of the transformational effort. My wife had a minute here.
Yeah, I've read your books.
Oh, here we go. Listen, they can sign up. It's a Facebook event, and at Functional Strength, or you can contact Stacy at somg1@comcast.net. And it's the workshops are filling up pretty quickly. We have a lot of high level professionals that come in. It's interesting, is that we have a great mix of absolute beginners in the highest levels of these world champion athletes and these elite military guys, but everyone can train together because the techniques and the tactics are the same. It's just what difference is the payloads and the intensities, right?
Right.
So it's an interesting mix, and again, it's we just want to spread the word, man. We're just getting really such good results for anybody that is able to get a piece of our system, and we buy their time back. It's you don't have to spend 6 hours in the gym a week, and you're probably not getting any results for your 6 hours anyway. So let's maybe change some things up and let's get some people some real results. We certainly can do that.
Yeah. Yeah. It makes sense to me. I'm sure that is a big hit, and I appreciate your time and,
Thank you.
And we'll certainly spread it around. I'll get it published today. And so I'll go ahead and stop the recording, and I'll talk to you for just a second after I stop it.
Sure.
Yes, sir. Thanks again.
Thank you.